I want you to know what we're looking at today. I know it's a little bit hard to read or see up here on the board, but this is a stagnated piece of water. This pool is stagnated because, as you understand, it does not move. There's no movement in it. There's no inlet, no outlet. And when it's no inlet, no outlet, and it sits still, obviously there's growth that takes place in it, but it's growth of bacteria. It's a lukewarm pond. It's not hot. It's not cold. And because of the scenario with the being lukewarm, without an inlet, without an outlet, it stagnates. And what I want to be spending time with today is just looking at what is involved. You can say, well, I'm moving. And you and I, in Rochester, all of us seem to be moving at a very fast pace in Rochester. And the other parts, it's not like that. We were down in Missouri a few weeks ago, and it's really slow pace down there. A lot different than it is up here in Rochester, very fast moving. But you can imagine, even that stagnated pond is moving. The earth is moving around the sun at 67,000 miles an hour. That's moving. But that surface of that water is not moving. And just because you are moving physically does not mean you're moving spiritually. In fact, if you looked at a proportional chart, you're probably disproportionate, as the faster you move, the less you move spiritually. You probably are going downhill if you're moving fast physically. The faster you move physically, probably the less time you have really to move spiritually. And so that becomes an issue. Physical growth does not necessarily mean spiritual growth, and it's difficult sometimes to tell the difference. A church can be moving physically at a very fast pace, doing everything that it needs to do with its programs, and yet the people in that church are not growing spiritually. There may have been a time in your life where you were really on fire for the Lord a whole lot more than you are now. Obviously, we believe in a progressive sanctification. We believe that we are moving toward Christ's likeness, and at some point in the future, God is going to perfect that. That which He's begun, He will complete it when Jesus Christ returns, and we will be like Him, for we'll see Him as He is. But in your life right now, your progressive sanctification may, at a point, stagnate. In fact, you may be going downhill. You may not be growing. You may be having a time in your life where you're getting less desire for the Lord than you had in the past. And of course, we want to avoid that. We don't want that to be the case. And so our question is, how do you know if you're really growing? How do you know if you're stagnated? If you are getting to a point where there's no inlet, no outlet, and the only thing that's growing is bacteria. So we're going to take a few points out of Colossians. In chapter 1, it says, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae, grace be to you and peace from God the Father and Lord Jesus Christ. And the first thing I want you to know is, are you faithful? Faithfulness is a huge part of growth. The Bible makes faithfulness a part of stewardship. Of course, in 1 Corinthians 4:2, it says, moreover, it is required in stewards that a man be found faithful. And so what God desires for men and women more than anything is to be faithful. I want you to know there's a very close correlation between faith and faithfulness. Faithful is the word pistos. The word faith is pistis. Very, very similar words. Faith, I believe, is an inlet. Faithfulness is an outlet. We have this inlet coming into our life because faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And as you have the Word of God come into your life, it promotes faith in your life. And with that faith, that leads to you being trustworthy, or being God being able to depend upon you in faith, that God can have faith in you and your work. And so faithfulness becomes an outlet. Faith becomes the inlet. And so when it comes to that, you understand, and we've shared with this with you many times, nothing that you have in your house, in your possession, really belongs to you as a Christian, as a believer. Yeah, as a world, that may be true. That may be your possession. But our inheritance is not our house. Our inheritance is not our car. Our inheritance is not even our job or our intelligence. Our inheritance is the Lord Jesus Christ. And there, someone comes and your phone rings and someone needs a place to stay. And you just say on the line, well, God has given me one of His homes for me to live in, and there's extra room in the house that God has given to me. And so, yeah, you're welcome to come and stay with us. Someone calls you and they need transportation, they need a car, and you have a car sitting in the driveway that you don't need this week. And you simply say, God has given me one of His cars to use. And I get the privilege of using one of His cars, but it's really His. And so if you need it this week, I'm sure God would love to have you be able to use that car. And it's true of everything that we own, everything that we possess really belongs to Him. Now again, I want you to understand that that is a battle in my heart. That's not necessarily as easy as it sounds. Because I really want to take possession of things. I want to say it's mine. That's kind of like a two-year-old. It's Liam's car. Pick it out, Liam, there. But it's Liam's chair. It's Dwight's chair. It's Dwight's card. And I like that. And it's a battle that takes place inside of me because I really do like to have possession. And God has made it very clear that the things that I have are not our own. They belong to Him, and we are stewards of that. And the thing that's more important than anything for a steward is to be found faithful. In other words, what does that mean? It means I use what God has given to me for His interest, not for my interest. I'm faithful with what God has given me to make sure that it fits His will, not my will. That's not always easy. Now, I want you to understand, in order for us to receive from God, we must be found faithful. That's part of what it means. He that is faithful in that which is least is faithful in much. And so oftentimes, there's a reason why some person has more than another person. Because God will give to a person based upon the fact that God has proven that person to be faithful in a little thing. He may give you something small to begin with. And as you are faithful with that small thing, God begins to give you more things. Because He realizes you're not going to absorb that and you're not going to be the end of that. You know, one of the things I've shared with you so much in this church is nothing ends with you. You have in order so you can give. The purpose of having is giving. Your life, from the very moment you begin your life, God breathed into your nostrils a breath of life, and you inhale and you exhale. You inhale and you exhale. Yes, you need to inhale. You need to inhale and get the oxygen. You need to inhale, but listen, folks, you would not be alive if you didn't exhale. Everything about life is inhaling and exhaling. Everything about life is taking in and giving out. Everything about life is taking in and giving out. You've got to have an inlet and you have to have an outlet. And so the food that you take in, you have to take it in, but you also have to have an outlet for that. You have to have some way of using that energy. And so God has placed in our life many, many, many illustrations of this. And so when God gives to us, that's the inlet. What's the outlet? Where's the outlet? God gives to us, that's the inlet. And when it comes to salvation, salvation is not about you. So I'm saved. I have eternal life. No, that's not the point of salvation. You have it so you can give it to someone else. God gives you the Holy Spirit. The point of the Holy Spirit is so you'll have the Holy Spirit. No, that's not the point of the Holy Spirit. The point of the Holy Spirit is so you will have so that you can give out what God has given to you. He places gifts, He places fruit within you, and that gift and those fruit are given in turn to other people to help them grow. Discipleship is all about taking in and giving out. A church is not designed as a pastor getting up and giving to you. If that's what church is like for you, you've missed it. Your whole life you've missed it. Why? Because what you don't use, you will lose. Do you believe that? If you don't use it, you will lose it. And so your whole life you take in, take in, take in. But if you don't give out, you will lose all that you've taken in. It will be meaningless to you because you won't remember what the pastor preached 2 weeks ago. You won't remember what he preached a month ago or 2 years ago or 3 years ago. I could preach the same sermon every third year and you wouldn't remember it. Unless, I remember one man came up to me and said, "You preached this before. I have this notes in my Bible." Yeah, I have preached it before. And I really appreciate the fact that you wrote it down. And I appreciate the fact that you in turn can give it to someone else. Our Sunday school teachers do not impart knowledge. If that's your idea of what a Sunday school teacher does, you're wrong. Your job is not to impart knowledge. Your job is to give to them so they in turn can give to someone else. We commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. And so in your Sunday school lesson, you're saying and constantly saying to them, look at what it says, learn what it says so that you in turn can give it to someone else. If you miss it, you miss what church is all about. And frankly, I'm telling you, that's what has been one of the biggest problems we've had in church over all these years, is inlet without outlet. That's been the problem we've had in church for hundreds of years, is inlet without outlet. Secondly, I want you to know this: but he that knew not, but did commit things worthy of stripes, shall be beaten with few stripes. For unto whomsoever much is given, of him shall much be required. The more God gives to you, the more is required from you. I share with you all the time, every relationship demands a responsibility. And I've shared with you many times from the very first sermon I gave at Calvary was about relationship and responsibility. I shared with you that people today want relationship, but they don't want responsibility. They don't want the responsibility that goes along with it. They would like to live with a gal and have the relationship without the responsibility. They would like to come to church and raise their hands and worship God and then leave without responsibility. But Jesus said very, very clearly, if you love me, keep my commandments. If you love me, that's relationship. We want to love the Lord with all our heart, soul, and mind. But if you love him, keep his commandments. That's responsibility. And so every one of us have to be given. Now, frankly, folks, if you don't see that you have much required, that must indicate to me that you don't think much has been given to you. Because if you don't see much being given, you won't see much being required. But if you understand just how much God has given to you, then you begin to realize just how much is required of you by God, because he's given you so much. And he's blessed you with these spiritual gifts in heavenly places so that you're able to, in turn, use that responsibility as a steward to give to others. A growing Christian is one who is learning to give what has been given. A stagnant Christian is one who holds on to what he has been given. Again, it's all about the definition of stagnant. No inlet, no outlet. You have no inlet, no outlet. And that's true of teaching. If you give out, give out, give out, give out, but don't ever take anything in, what will happen to you? You will just plain dry up. If you have a pond that has an outlet without an inlet, you're going to dry up, you're going to be a desert. If you are a teacher of God's Word, but you don't study God's Word, if you don't get into God's Word and bring in the inlet, you will dry up. And that's another one problem that pastors have. But you can also understand, if you're an inlet without an outlet, what happens if you're an inlet but you don't have an outlet? Man, there comes a point when you fill up far enough where the inlet becomes the outlet. The water starts flowing in the wrong direction. Instead of coming into this pond, it starts going out of this pond. And you can try taking in God's Word, but if there's no outlet, you won't learn it. You won't be able to grasp it. You won't be able to receive it. You won't be able to retain it. Okay, do you understand what I'm saying? Three people, okay. Obviously, I'm kidding you. I think there's a lot more than that. But you can understand just how critical this is. Number two, how do you know if you're growing? Do you have faith in God? Do you have faith in Jesus Christ? We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we've heard of your faith in Christ. And again, that's a two-way thing. Obviously, faithful people need to be men of faith. Faith comes by hearing, hearing by the Word of God, which I shared with you the two words, faithful, pistos, pistis. Faithful is one who is trusty, one that you can have faith in. A lot of it just comes down to being desiring, really seeking God. Let me explain that. My dad was, I thought he was incredible. I mean, he was so popular. Everybody loved my dad. My dad was city council president. He was acting mayor for a long time. He was this president of the Duluth JCs. No matter what he did, he seemed to always have tons of friends. He was on fishing trips, on hunting trips with his friends all the time. Until God got a hold of his heart. When God got a hold of his heart, he put all of that energy into caring for people. And I told you that he would go to the church there in Wright, Minnesota. He became the pastor of that church when he retired. And he spent 60 miles one way to get to church. But he'd go to the hospital in Duluth, and anybody from Wright, Minnesota, Cromwell, Minnesota, Carlton, Minnesota, he would go to the hospital, you'd look him up, and he'd go into there, and he'd pray with them, and he said, now listen, if God heals you, you need to give glory to God. If God heals you, we prayed for you, and if God heals you, I want you to come to our church, and I want you to give a testimony. And he got lots of people from Cromwell, Carleton, right, to come to his church after they were healed and give a testimony. And of course, some of them came to know Christ. And that little church grew because her dad just had a compassion for people. So I wanted to be like him. I was nothing like him. I was so shy. My dad could make friends. I could not make any friends. But frankly, folks, if you want to be like your dad, you want to change into his image. It comes down to that word like. What do you desire? If you want to have a desire to be like your mom, you change in your mom's image. But if you want to have a desire to be like God, do you have a desire to be like God? Is that a hunger inside of you? Do you desire him? If you don't, obvious, we read, but we all with open face, beholding as in a mirror, glass is a mirror, the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. A person who is stagnant has stopped desiring God, and simply, it's all about desire. Have you been desiring him in your life? Do you desire to be like him? Number three, do you love the saints? Since we've heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and the love you have, I want you to just notice this to all of the saints. What Paul is saying here in this passage, again, is these people, obviously, they're not stagnant. They have great faith. They're faithful brethren. They have a love for people. But listen, they don't pick and choose the ones they love. It's not exclusive love. It's inclusive love. In other words, anybody who comes into this church building, they're a member of the body of Christ. We love them. It doesn't matter if they're our best friends. It doesn't matter. We will go out of our way to love people just because they're a part of the body of Christ. And frankly, that's not how it is in most churches. Most churches, you have your friends, and they're the ones you want to be with. But what God says here is that's what the Pharisees are like. For if you love them which love you, what reward have you? I'm sorry, not Pharisees, publicans. Publicans were Jewish people who collected taxes from their own people, which means they were the hated people of the Jewish. But they had friends. The publicans had friends. They may not have had you as a friend, but they had friends. They had love for one another. They cared for other publicans. People who are in this world, they have love for their friends as well as. And he says, I want you different than that. I don't want you like that. I don't want you to act like the world. I want you to be different from the world. I want you to be like God, which means I want you to, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. And we're living in a time period. I'm telling you, remember I said the first thing was hard? This is even harder than that. This is really, really hard. Because we're living in a time period where people are not only not liking God, they hate God. They hate everything he stands for. They hate law and order. They hate our country. And we are supposed to love those people? This is really, really difficult. Now listen, I'm not saying we love what they do. No, we don't love what they do. We don't love their anarchy. We don't love their rioting. We don't love any of that, do we? No, we don't love that. But the Bible is really clear that we love them. Because God died on the cross for them as well as for me. And so our love has to be inclusive of people. And we have to somehow try to demonstrate that, because the publicans, they love their friends. But do we love the people that come into this church? All the people that come into this church. That's what God is saying here. I want you to notice this. It's not a question of whether you love. I know you love. I know you love your family. I know you love your kids. You love your wife, your husband. I know you love. But that's not the point of stagnation. When I'm talking about stagnation, I mean that it doesn't increase. It stays the same. Because when you look at what the Bible says here, it says, the Lord make you to increase and abound in love. And indeed you do toward all the brethren, which are in Macedonia. We beseech you, brethren, that you increase more and more. What he's talking about there is, yes, love is great. A stagnated person loves. But that love needs to be growing more and more and more. What does that mean? It means I love more people, and I love people more. Let me say it again. I love more people and I love people more. As you love more people, God gives you an increased amount of love. As you love people more, God gives you an increased amount of love. He gives you more to give as you have more going out from you. Love has to have an inlet and an outlet. We need that love from God. We need to understand we love Him because He first loved us. But that's not why God loves us. God doesn't love us because we first loved Him. In order for us to be like God, we have to understand that even if people don't love us, we love them back. We have to be different than what the world is like. We have to love people whether they love us or not. We have to love them. But the point of stagnation is if our love is the same, if it's not increasing, that's stagnation. If we're not learning to love more people, if we're not learning to love people more, that's stagnation. And we have to pray that God would give us a different kind of heart to care for people in a greater way, to care for more people in a greater way. Stagnation. Do you produce good fruit? For the hope that is laid up for you in heaven, where have you heard the word of the truth, the gospel, which is coming to you as in all the world and brings forth fruit as it does also in you since the day you heard of it. It brings forth fruit. Okay, so the next point that I'm talking about is fruit. And listen, you can have a lot of good things on the tree. You know, I've had a lot of different trees. We had a tree behind our church in Faith Baptist Church. There used to be a nursery there, and I'd go back there and I'd pick an apple off that tree. It was the worst tasting apple ever. I don't know how you could eat that. It was sour, it was bitter, it tasted awful, and it just didn't seem to ever get ripe. Looked good, the tree looked good, the apples looked good, but they tasted horrid. Now, listen, according to the Bible, a good tree does not produce corrupt fruit. If you produce corrupt fruit, you're a corrupt tree. If you produce good fruit, you're a good tree. No matter how you look, if you produce good fruit, you're a good tree. But if you produce corrupt fruit, you're a bad tree. And so it's really difficult just saying, well, I love people, but I have this problem in my life. It's corrupt. If you have a corrupt problem in your life, it's not a good tree. Even so, every good tree brings forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. And again, once you may think that you're doing great, but again, the definition of corrupt fruit is he that sows to the flesh. And so one of the things that becomes a problem again is what is the inlet, what's the outlet? If the inlet is the flesh, if the outlet's the flesh, it's going to be corrupt. If the inlet is the spirit, the outlet's the spirit, it's going to be good fruit. But it has a lot to do with what the source and what the and where it's heading. But he that sows to the flesh is the problem here. Obviously, I've shared this with you many, many times. But again, I use this as an illustration. My garage floor is probably the dirtiest place on the face of the earth. Okay, I sweep it, I put brake cleaner on it, I wipe it up, but it's dirty. Now, I haven't done this, but if I took a bucket of water and I went out there with a sponge and washed that floor with a sponge, I can promise you that bucket would be really, 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 really dirty when I got done. Sorry about that. I don't live in the garage. I have a lot of other things in the garage. So the garage floor is dirty. So let's say I have this sponge that I just washed the garage floor with, okay? Now I take that sponge and I turn on the water in the faucet and I rinse it out. And when I rinse it out, the outside of the sponge starts to look orange again. It starts to look clean again. That is what a lot of Christians are like. They are really clean on the outside, but what happens when you squeeze that sponge? It's a difference between rinsing it under the water and squeezing it. When you squeeze it, what comes out of the sponge is what's in the middle of that sponge. Not on the surface, but it's what's in the middle. And you, oh man, is that dirty. Now obviously, if you put it back under the water and you rinse it a number of times, you can get the inside of that sponge clean as well. But what happens is you come to church on Sunday and you get the outside cleaned and you're smiling and people look at you. Hi, brother so-and-so. Oh, man, it's so good to see you. It's so great. But what you're careful of is God puts us in pressure situations at work. When you're driving your car and you didn't even know that stuff was in your heart until that guy pulled in front of you. And my wife knows what's in my heart sometimes when people cut in front of me on the highway. But he said, oh man, I didn't even know that was in there. But you get that and you squish it hard enough, and the stuff that's in the middle of that sponge comes out. Hey, listen, you look great on Sunday mornings. Sunday mornings, when you're rinsing the water on it, it looks great until it's squeezed. And I'm telling you, that's one of the things that God is doing to the church right now. I think that's one of the things that God is doing in America right now. I think God is taking churches and he's squeezing them. I think what God is doing is inside of pastors, he's squeezing them. And I think what God is doing inside of people that come to church is squeezing them. And we may think that we look pretty good in the mirror. We look pretty good when we comb our hair. We look pretty good when we see ourselves, and that's how other people see us. But God is not looking at the outside, is he? Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. And so for him to look at the heart requires sometimes for him to do some squeezing. And when he squeezes that, we are appalled at how rotten that stuff looks that comes out of our heart. And so we just ask God's forgiveness, and we go back underneath the water and we say, God, squeeze us some more. Squeeze us some more. We want to get rid of that stuff that's in the middle of that sponge. You know, this is all about inlet and outlet. You can imagine what it's like if you have no outlet, if you're never squeezed. If there's no outlet, if you never squeeze out what's in that sponge, you can get a lot of corruption inside of that sponge and you never know it. We pulled one of the my workbench that's been in my garage for a long time, we pulled it away from the wall yesterday and threw it away. It's been there for 23 years. Well, there was a dead mouse under it. But I've never seen a dead white mouse. I don't know if they get white because they've been dead for a long time. I don't know if it's just because it's an old dead mouse that they get white. I don't know. Or it was either someone's pet mouse, but he was white. Never seen a white mouse like that, white before. But anyway, having said that, you have it underneath. I would hate to move my, don't tell this to Logan. He's by my house. But underneath that shed, I know there are volumes of dead animals under that shed. It has smelled bad for a long time. But anyway, I used to have woodchucks, and the woodchucks lived underneath that, and they're big. Those woodchucks, they would come and sun themselves on the tar. Okay, this big. I'm from the platform, not from the ground. Okay, but they were big, Peggy, weren't they big? And one time I ran over, I think 12 or 20 of them, I ran over in the lawnmower and I minced them up a little bit because they were in the ground. But the ones underneath my shed, I don't know ever what happened to them. I put poison there and they died. They must have died underneath the shed. And so it really smelled bad for a long, long time. Well, it still smells bad. But don't tell Logan. Pressure sometimes reveals what's in the heart, and God allows us to go through that because it's so important. And I just want to stop with this because this is going to be really important. We have two more points, but real quickly, it's redundant. A growing Christian needs to keep growing. It's redundant, I know that. But this is one of the frustrations of a pastor. This is what really, really pricks at a pastor's heart. You have Bible studies in the church, but no one wants to come to the Bible studies. They have enough Sunday morning. They come to church Sunday morning. They get enough Bible Sunday morning. They don't need any more than that. Once a week, that's plenty enough for us. I just want you to know that if you're going to grow as a Christian, you need to have a good inlet. And you think coming to church once a week is plenty enough to have a good inlet. Well, frankly, folks, it's not. You need to have times to be in God's Word. And when God's Word is being instructing or being given out, being taught to you, you need to take advantage of that. You need to be in church and hearing what God's Word is saying. You need to be a part of Bible studies. You need to be a part of church where you can learn. Some of you learn at home. Some of you are on correspondence. Some of you learn by live streaming other programs, and that's great. That's wonderful. It doesn't have to be in this church. But I'm just saying that God gives in a local church. He does provide in a local church teachers. That's his design. He designs teachers in a local church to teach you God's word. And you have this privilege of being able to sit under different teachers and be able to open up the word of God and learn. And a growing Christian needs to grow. It's not enough for you to think, I grew when I went to Bible college 20 years ago. I grew when I studied God's word 20 years ago. That's not going to do it for you. It's not past tense. Stagnation is present tense. Growth involves taking in. Growth involves hungering and thirsting. I don't know if your mom ever said to you, don't eat that because it'll ruin your appetite. I don't know why a big bag of Doritos would ruin my appetite. I'll eat that bag of Doritos and I'll still have room for that pork chop. And you get to the table after eating the whole bag of Doritos and you're just not hungry. Well, I'll eat the pork chop, but I'm not eating the broccoli. I just don't have any room for the broccoli. Well, there's ice cream. Oh, I'll have room for ice cream. The problem is when you do that, what you let go is stuff that's good for you. You normally don't eat the things that are good for you if you ruin your appetite by eating snacks. The snacks are not good for you, but you will ruin your appetite for the things that are good for you, right? Well, that's what this is all about. What this is about is God says this, He humbled thee and suffered you to hunger. He suffered you to hunger. God gave you hunger. Why? That you may know that man doth not live by bread alone, but by every word. In other words, so you would know what is good for you, not just what you like, what you think tastes good, but what's good for you. God allowed you to hunger so that you'd understand what's good for you. And God said, blessed are they which hunger and thirst after righteousness. That's what's good for you. That's the broccoli. And I hate to say it, but that's probably asparagus too, even though I have told you that asparagus is not really an edible food. It's part of the fall of man. Anyway, when we hunger for the things of God, He fills us, for He satisfies the longing soul, and He fills the hungry soul with goodness. God provides the needs of that hungry soul. Now again, we're just closing with this then, and the point is, who has declared unto us your love in the Spirit, Colossians 1:8, your love in the Spirit, it just ends with almost the same way He starts again, is God wants your love to increase, not just for people, but for Him. He wants you to grow in your love for Him. And I can promise you the biggest problem that Satan wants is for you to get out of your relationship with God. But you don't have time for God. You don't have time for praying with Him. You don't have time for being in His Word. You don't have time to learn from Him. You don't have time to fellowship with Him. You check your box. Yes, I did this. Yes, you check your box, but you don't fellowship with Him. Now, you can imagine if you are married and you've been married for, in my case, 46 years. 46 years, and I really appreciate the girl that God has given to me. She's an incredible wife. But, you know, I can mow the grass for her. I can do the dishes for her. I can do all of the things that I've done for her and keep doing all those things that I've done for her and not fellowship with her. And I can think that I'm loving her, but if I don't spend time with her, it's not a question of what I'm doing, it's a question of her as a person, am I fellowshipping with her? Otherwise, I'm stagnating. Well, there's Christians that go through all of the routine of going to church, having communion, doing their Bible lesson, getting on Zoom, sitting in church. But if you have not had that fellowship with Him, and that's what this is all about, isn't it? Am I stagnating? Have I had that fellowship with our Lord that I'm growing to love Him more, that I desire Him more, I want to be with Him more, and I'm teaching my kids what it means to have a passion for God, not just a duty to perform, but a passion for Him. And I'm trying to pass on a passion. And you can't pass it on unless it's real with you. So you're trying to pass on this passion for your kids. Because the most critical matter is not whether you're checking off a box, but whether you're really growing in your love, that you have a love in the Holy Spirit. It's declared. Everyone can see it. Now let me just share with you in closing, and I know this is off topic, but listen. Jesus Christ loved you so much that he died upon the cross for you. He knows you're a sinner. He knows I'm a sinner. He knows there's a lot of dirt in the middle of that sponge. And he wants to clean us from that, but I do want you to understand that in order to get to heaven, you have to be perfect. You can't be sinful. You have to be perfect to get to heaven. There are two types of righteousness in the Bible. There's the righteousness of man, and there's the righteousness of God. Religion says you're saved by the righteousness of man. God says you're saved by the righteousness of God. You're not going to get to heaven by the righteousness of man. Religion says if you do good, if you're sincere, you'll get to heaven. But they're wrong. That's not how you get to heaven. In fact, if you try, you're not going to get there. Because God can't live with sin, and you have to have your sin paid for. So Jesus Christ came to this earth. He died on the cross for your sins. He took all of your sin. He paid for it by dying for you and giving you his righteousness as a free gift. 2 Corinthians 5:21, for he, God, hath made him, Jesus Christ, to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Philippians 3:9, and be found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is of the law, but that which is through the faith of Christ, the righteousness which is of God by faith. I can have God's righteousness. It's a free gift. He died on the cross, and he gives us that righteousness if we receive it. And we receive it by faith by just saying, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I know you died on the cross for me. Best I know how, I want to accept you as my Savior. Please forgive me of my sins. And if you do that, God promises to forgive you. He gives you a guarantee of forgiveness. He gives you a guarantee of eternal life. So if you haven't done that, I want to encourage you to do that this morning.
I want to thank you for tuning into our program. It's been a delight to have you. I trust that you understand a little bit more about what Jesus Christ did for you when he died on the cross. Salvation is not something that you receive because you're born into a family or because you go to church or because you're good. Salvation is a free gift, but that gift has to be received. If you have not received it, we'd like to have you take some time to talk to God and ask him that he might be your Savior. You understand that you are a sinner, that Jesus Christ died for you, that you can know that you have eternal life by putting your trust in Christ today.